Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. Father, I pray that you would touch every life in this place, Lord, that we would become a little bit more like Jesus with a little bit more glory today. Father, I pray also that we would love each other deeply from the heart and that each person would be drawn closer to the next and closer to you at the same time. Father, we ask that you would receive us now. Father, I pray you speak to us through your servant, through your spirit, and through your word, that we would leave here saying, truly it was good to be in the house of the Lord, as it were. We just ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Are you ready to stand and sing a little bit? This is called Days of a Lot. We're good, testing. There we go. Days of Elijah, if you can find it in your song booklets there, it should be the first one, I believe. Here we go.
Salvation comes.
Well done, well done. Praise the Lord. Well, this next song talks about the fact that our God is everlasting God, and we just have to wait on Him, and our strength will rise. So hopefully as you're going through difficulties in life, you just continue to wait on God, and you sense His grace and His mercy and His strength to get you through the day. Strength will rise. So now that you're warmed up a little bit, we're going to ask you to put your hands together on this one. We don't have our drums out here, of course, but we could use your hands. I'm sorry. We have one amazing drummer here. Sorry, Christian. My bad. There we go. Here we go. When you're ready, brother. All right. See, hold on. Here's the problem. When I said we had a drummer, you didn't clap. Okay, we don't have a drummer right now. Is that all right? So we need you guys to clap. Come on. It's a nice little tempo there. You got it, all right? Let's try it again. We'll keep stopping if we have to. Here we go. Tough. And not just academically, but in all different social ways as well.
And so we want God's blessing to pour down to you. And church, would you agree to that?
Amen.
Would you stand? And I'm going to ask that you would reach out your hands as if you were putting your hands on each one of these kids. And we're just going to do that to a couple of you guys, okay? Just pray. Loving Father, we thank you so much for your presence in this place. And again, we are reminded by the wind of the Holy Spirit that came and touched so many lives on that Pentecost day. Father, I pray right now, as the wind goes through, you would touch every one of these boys and girls, Lord, that you would bring them to yourself. Father, you draw them close, that they would sense how much they are loved by you. And Father, as they begin this school year, I pray that your protection would be upon them, both in their hearts and in their bodies. Father, and I pray that they would be a blessing to the people that they come in contact with. Be with their teachers, Father, be with their parents. And Father, may this be a year that changes their lives and glorifies you. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. You guys were perfect. Thank you. Now get out of here. All right. You guys follow off the children's church. Well, praise the Lord. That's the 8345. There we go. Okay. We just have just a couple of quick announcements we need to make you aware of. Just want to let you know, this is going to be our venue in a few weeks for our Harvest Fest. And we're going to be having church here. And right after that, we're going to have a huge picnic, as it were, church picnic, as well as all kinds of games and stuff. A great opportunity to fellowship. You can invite anybody you want, but if you're going to be inviting an army, let us know so we have enough food for sure. I'm going to ask you to bring some stuff with you if you can. But that's coming up in just a couple of weeks. Today is our last baptism of the year. Now, we know that we missed August because of the rain, and then because of the high, the fast water, and then because of the high water. And so we already have a bunch of people scheduled for next June in the river, but today is our last baptism, and it is at the home of the DiCarlos. There they are in the back. Thank you for being with us. They have been making Italian food all week long. No, I'm kidding. I'm not, no obligation. But they are hosting it at their house. It's over in Bethlehem Township. If you need directions, it should be in your bulletin. We do not want to announce that over the air, but it is at their home in Bethlehem Township, and you will be blessed. That's going to begin at 4 o'clock. I think we have at least 10 people already that are going to be baptized. And if you are one, I want you to hear me on this, because this is it for the year. If you are one who maybe was baptized as an infant, you come from a tradition like I came from, Presbyterian, that baptizes infants, or Methodist, or Lutheran, or Episcopalian. Those are what we call high church liturgies, and they follow kind of the Catholic tradition as well of baptizing infants. But not to offend anybody, I just don't see that, nor do most evangelical churches see that that is supported in Scripture, that baptism is a way to associate, for the individual being baptized, to associate with Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. Paul writes about it in Romans and in Colossians. In addition to that, it's another way of having your faith enhanced. And we're going to talk about that at the baptism. But you no longer just have the faith in Jesus Christ. You take on the faith of Jesus Christ, which changes you forever. So we're going to talk about that at the baptism. If you've never been baptized that way, never of your own free will, maybe you were coerced, maybe your parents baptized you, maybe you just thought it was a good thing to do, but you never really really did it on your own, we want to invite you to this. You can come, and if you want to do that, you need to talk to me first. So just see me after the service is over. I think those are the announcements that I have. Pastor, the community breakfast, that is coming up in 2 weeks. 2 weeks. So kind of put that on your calendar. We need help for the community breakfast over in the Crossbar at the main campus there. And if you can see Mike or Gene Lynn on that, that would be helpful. Any other hands? Not seeing any other hands. Brother, would you come forward and share with us the scripture that talks about Jesus being tempted in the wilderness? Would you give our brother your attention? Thanks, brother.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
You could follow along as we read, or as I read, Matthew 4, 1 through 11. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to him and said, "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread." And Jesus answered, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and they will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone." Then Jesus answered him, "It is also written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in their splendor. "All this I will give you if you will bow down and worship me." And Jesus said to him, "Away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." Then the devil left him, and the angels came and attended to him. That ends the reading. Thank you.
Thank you, Ray, for reading God's word to us. I would ask that all of you just bow your heads. I know so many of you have needs. You need a special touch from the Lord today. So many of your needs are serious. So I just will take a moment here in silence and ask that you pray for those things that come to your mind. Lord Jesus, in the beauty of your creation, we sit here on this property that you have given us. We thank you, Lord, that you have provided it for us and given us a means to be able to worship you in this place. Lord, we think of all those that we have lost through death in the past year. But we know, Lord, and we have sung and we have praised your holy name, that you have conquered death, and they are with you. We pray, Lord, for those that don't know you, Lord, that may not have a personal relationship with you. We pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit will truly sweep this place, and that people will understand that you are the only way to heaven, and you conquer in death. And we praise your holy name that you loved us so much, that you died on the cross, and then you proved that you were God by your resurrection. So now, Lord, we also pray, Lord, for all those that are ministering to you, for you today, Lord. And you'll give them the words to say, Lord. We think of Pastor Wilson as he's in the hospital room and maybe doing a Zoom ministry to that church, Lord. We pray, Lord, that you would provide a special blessing to him, Lord, that you'll touch his body and that you'll bless that church as they listen and as they worship even now. We thank you, Lord, for our missionaries as they committed their lives to you and they're abroad in the world, Lord, in many places and hostile places where they have to be careful not to speak openly about you or they'll be in jail, Lord. So we pray, Lord, your protection on them. For our troops and our men who serve, Lord, just pray, Lord, that you would just be with them in a special way, even now, Lord. We thank you for their service, Lord. We pray now, Lord, for Pastor Randy as he comes, that you'll give him the words to say, and that we will listen and understand that these are your words for us today, and we may we go away changed as a result of it. In thy holy name, amen.
Thank you, Don.
Where do you need me? Am I okay?
Yep.
Okay, very good. Well, church, I want to share with you that I believe that this message is really critical, especially in the days in which we live, to not just hear it, but to say, how am I going to implement what I heard on that Sunday every single day of my life? I really think this is going to be really the difference between whether or not we wash out or we live for Christ. If I were to ask you this question, and I don't need you to say anything verbally, but if I were to ask you, what is more important, prayer or the study of God's Word? I'm wondering what you would say. If I were to ask you what's more important to you, as distinguished by the effort and the time that you take for each, what would you say was more important? Now, it may be an unfair question because you can actually pray a lot. You pray throughout the day. You can pray while you're working, perhaps. You can pray while you're driving. You can pray over your meals, of course. You can pray when you have lulls in your day. You can be in a state of unending prayer. So maybe the time factor is an issue. But even the effort that you're actually concentrating in the time that you're praying versus taking time to study God's Word. Now, that might only be an hour a day or a half hour a day, or 15 minutes a day, or maybe it's 5 minutes a day. But what is the most important thing of those two things? Which is more important to you? Now, before you start an argument with me or a debate with me as to what you think is more important, I would dare say that both of them are extremely important. If you're going to have an upright walk and you're going to be walking closer and closer to Jesus, you need to spend time in prayer with Him every single day. Would you say amen to that?
Amen.
That is something where you're communing with the one who made you, loved you. But reading God's Word or listening to it is essential as well. Every single day, if possible. This is not one of those things where, you know, you feel, okay, this is an obligation, I've got to do it. But this is something where we learn more about what God has said, what has come from the mouth of God. There may be things that keep you from doing one or the other. Maybe you don't read God's Word because you have a hard time reading. Maybe you don't read God's Word because you have a hard time seeing. Your sight is gone. Or maybe it's because you have difficulty comprehending what you've read or just learning in general. These are things that may cause you to say, you know what, I don't want to read so much, but I want to encourage you to listen to God's Word. I have it on my CD. If you ever get in my truck and you drive away or you're doing something in my truck, you will hear that CD kicks on. And it'll be where I left off. And I just keep saturating my mind with it. I don't always have time to sit down and a block of time and do it. But I'm always in the Word. So, it's not my desire today to tell you which one is more important. What it is my desire is to tell you the importance of the one. And that is the studying of God's Word as Jesus explains it. I want you to see how important the Word of God is to Jesus in perhaps one of the most powerful illustrations we can see. So we're going to get into that. It's not coercive. It's not manipulative. It's not trying to guilt you into it. And hopefully we'll say, wow, this was so important to Jesus. It's got to be important to me. Are you with me, church?
Yes.
All right, so we're going to pray and we're going to get right into it. Heavenly Father, we thank you once again for this beautiful, beautiful day. No humidity, cool, gentle Holy Spirit breezes going through. Father, we thank you for this group that has gathered together as a family, for the love that we have for one another. And Father, I pray that as we delve into your word right now, as we consider this temptation of Jesus, Father, as we learn together at your feet, I pray that you would be our teacher, that you would speak to me and through me, that only your message would be proclaimed. Lord, that you would keep us from all distractions, and as beautiful of a place as this is going to have more and more distractions than other places. But Lord, I pray we would be laser focused on you in this very brief time we have together. And Lord, I pray that you would work a miracle from my lips to the hearer's ears, that they would hear exactly what you want them to hear today. And I'll give you the praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Perhaps
some of the most powerful words that Jesus ever said about studying the Bible, about listening to the Word of God. The most powerful words he ever said, he said to the most wicked being on the planet. He said it to Satan. And when he said it, he said these words were so significant that every single word needs to be taken at its uttermost. I'd like you to take your Bibles if you have them with you. And again, if you come out to the tent, you're going to need to bring some Bible with you since we don't have the screen here, of course. I'm going to ask that you would turn to the passage that Ray read for us. And thank you, brother, for doing that. It's the temptation of Jesus. Excuse me. Matthew chapter 4, starting with verse 1. We may be here a while, just to let you know. And I'll tell you why in just a moment. Let's look at the first verse here. It says, then Jesus was led by the Spirit. Let's stop at that first word, then. Like I said, we're going to be here a while. When he says then, you have to ask, okay, when was the then? If you go back just a couple of verses in chapter 3 and verse 16, it says, as soon as Jesus was baptized, he went up out of the water, and at that moment, listen carefully, at that
moment, heaven was opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, this is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased. Now, I want to stop for a second. I want you to go to theology class for a moment because there is a heresy out there. It's called modalism. Have anybody ever heard of the word modalism? Only a few of you, and the same with the other service. Modalism teaches that there is one God. There's not one God manifest in three persons called the Trinity, but there's one God. And sometimes God puts on the mode or the hat of Father, and sometimes of the Son, and sometimes of the Holy Spirit. But there's not three persons. There's one person. He just changes his responsibilities. That's called modalism. And I want to share with you, if you fight against modalism in different ways, this is one of those passages, because here we see all three of them. We see the Trinity. People say the Trinity isn't mentioned in the Scripture. The Word isn't, but the actuality is there in many instances. The name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we're supposed to baptize in. Jesus calling out to the Father, right, on the cross. We know that there's Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and here's one of those times where Jesus is being baptized, and the heavens open, and God the Father says, this is my Son, in whom I am well pleased. And the Holy Spirit comes and lights on him like a dove. So when it says then, that's what it's talking about. He's just gotten done being baptized. And it says, then Jesus was led by the Spirit. Now, the Holy Spirit just descended on him like a dove. So I don't know if you ever got this picture in your mind. I never really thought about it. But now you got the dove there. I can just see the dove say, okay, Jesus, let's go. And the dove just flies in front of him until he gets to the desert, into the wilderness. Does that kind of ring sensible to you guys, that the Holy Spirit led him into the desert to be tempted by the devil? Now, after fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. And the tempter came to him and said, if you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread. And Jesus answered, it is written, man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. Then the devil took him to the holy city and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. If you are the Son of God, he said, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and they will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. Jesus answered him, it is also written, do not put the Lord your God to the test. Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain, and he showed him all the kingdoms of the world and all their splendor. All this I will give you, he said, if you will bow down and worship me. Jesus said to him, away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. Then the devil left him, and the angels came and attended him. I want to kind of look at this dialogue a little bit here. And some of you say, you know what, you should never really talk with the devil. Don't even engage him in any conversation, because that's what happened with Adam and Eve, right? Adam and Eve, they should just never have talked to him, and all this mess wouldn't have happened, perhaps. Well, Jesus went out into the wilderness specifically for the purpose of having a conversation with the great examiner, with the great tempter. So he was there for that exact purpose. Now, I want you to look at it. If you look at it, it says, the tempter came to him in verse 3 and said, if you are the Son of God. Now, I want to give you a little Greek lesson once again. Very little word in Greek. It's the Greek word A. It's spelled E-I, epsilon iota, and it means if or since. Both of them are acceptable. If or since. If you are the Son of God. A. If you are the Son of God. But let me tell you something. The most natural use of this, in fact, I looked up the analytical Greek lexicon, and it says this. This word A is used to express a condition of fact regarded as true or settled. The matter is settled. Since you are the Son of God. There's no dancing around here with the devil and Jesus. He knows exactly who he is. The demons know who he is. You are the Son of the Most High God. What do you have to do with us? Are you here to torment us before the appropriate time? Do you remember those conversations? Everybody knows who Jesus is, and certainly Satan, created by Jesus himself, because Jesus is the great creator, knows who Jesus is. So it's not a matter of if you are the Son of God. He's not playing games here. He says, since you are the Son of God, there is no debate. Now he says, since you are the Son of God, would you save yourself? Listen carefully to how the devil comes in. He sounds like a compassionate one, doesn't he? Jesus, you are starving to death. You've been going 40 days without food. Most of you are saying, Pastor, when will you be quiet? I'm starving. I haven't eaten since breakfast, and I had a sandwich in the car. And you're saying, when? When can I eat again, right? Jesus was fasting for 40 days and 40 nights. And so the devil comes to Jesus, you're the Son of God. You can save you. You can stop all this. Jesus truly was starving to death. Let me take you over to Matthew chapter 6, if you will. In Matthew chapter 6, it's the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus is talking about fasting for just a moment. And by the way, it's kind of expected as followers of Jesus that we would fast from time and again. He doesn't say if you fast, but in verse 16, Jesus says, when you fast, do not look somber as the hypocrites do, for they disfigure their faces to show men that they are fasting. I tell you the truth, they have received their reward in full. But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face, so that it will not be obvious to men that you are fasting, but only to your Father who is unseen. And your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. Let me just pause and explain something to you. A normal Jewish fast goes like this. It goes from sunrise to sunset. That means you, if you know you're going to be fasting that day, you can get up early in the morning and you can have your bacon and egg. Well, not as a Jewish boy, you can't have the bacon, but you can have your eggs and your toast, your marmalade. You can have your coffee and your juices. And you can have your cereal with your milk, and you have all that, and you stuff yourself before the sun rises. You follow me? Then all the way through till sunset. And as soon as sun sets, then you can go stuff yourself again. That's a typical Jewish fast. All you're doing is skipping lunch, and you're already filled up before and after. It's not much of a sacrifice, but the people would go around as if they had done something spectacular in sacrificing, and they would disfigure their face. Their jaw would be hanging on the ground, as it were. Look at me. I'm sacrificing for the Lord. I'm fasting. I'm going without lunch. A true austere individual wants to take it a little bit more seriously might go a whole day, 24 hours. In fact, somebody who's really self-righteous might go for 2 days in 1 week. Would you take your Bibles and go over? I want you to show the significance of this is what Jesus did with 40 days. In Luke chapter 18, there's a parable about two men. Listen carefully. To some, Jesus is speaking, to some who were confident of their own righteousness, and they looked down on everybody else, Jesus told this parable. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood up and prayed about himself, God, I thank you that I'm not like other men, robbers, evildoers, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week, and I give a tenth of all that I get. But the tax collector stood at a distance, and he would not even look up to heaven. But he beat his breast, and he said, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Jesus said, I tell you that this man, rather than the other, went home justified before God. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. Now here's the idea, that this man was above everybody else. I'm better than even the people who fast once a week, because I fast twice a week. I miss two lunches out of 21 meals. That's how righteous I am. All right, look at what Jesus does. He doesn't do the sunrise to sunset. In fact, it says that he fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, which he did 24 hours straight for 40 days. The Bible says, the medical profession says that after missing one meal, your body starts to react. Imagine missing three meals a day for 40 days. Your body will start to consume itself. The proteins start to break down. Your muscles start to deteriorate. And Jesus was literally starving. His whole body was being affected. And that's when Satan hits him. What does he do? He says, Jesus, save yourself. I don't want you to die. At least not yet. I don't want you to die. I want you to save yourself. Just do what I tell you to do. And it's reasonable, Jesus. You're the Son of God. You can cause stones to become the best tasting bread on the planet. You can eat and you can be made alive again. What does Jesus say? Listen carefully. And this, if this is so important to a starving man who is going to die soon if he doesn't get food, he says this to Satan, man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. That's how important it is for us to know the Word of God, that it's more important than we eat food. So I'm going to challenge you. You don't have to take up this challenge. It's just a thought. I used to do this, and I got away from it, but here's the thing. If you're able to physically do this, some of you can't. Some of you, as soon as you get up because of some physical ailment, you have to eat right away. Your blood sugar levels need to be adjusted and all that. I get that. But if you're able, I'm going to challenge you not to eat any physical food until you've gotten some spiritual food. That you get into God's Word before you start any part of your day. And then you have your second breakfast, like the hobbits, right? They have two breakfasts, I think. Have your spiritual breakfast first, and then you have your physical breakfast. I did this for years, but here's the problem. I did it for years, and I said, man, this is great. I'm in the Word. And then it got to a point where I was really hungry. And I thought, oh, man, I missed breakfast. Fortress, my God, in whom I trust. Surely he will save you from the fowler's snare and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness will be your shield and your rampart. You will not fear the terror of night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, nor the plague that destroys at midday. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. You will only observe with your eyes and see the punishment of the wicked. If you make the Most High your dwelling, even the Lord, who is my refuge, then no harm will befall you. No disaster will come near your tent. For he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. That's what Satan used. You will tread upon the lion and the cobra. You will trample the great lion and the serpent. Because he loves me, says the Lord, I will rescue him. I will protect him, for he acknowledges my name. He will call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. I had to read that whole thing. It's a beautiful psalm where David talks about the presence of the Lord and that God walks with us through every challenge and every difficulty and every danger. It's not God saying, listen, jump off of a high building and see if you won't die. It's not saying, go run in front of a train as it's moving and God will protect you and he won't let your foot strike against a stone. He's not saying, go run off into traffic and he'll be there and guard you. That's foolishness. That's recklessness. And Jesus calls Satan on it. And he says, it's also written, don't put the Lord your God to the test. Don't test him. Don't try him in this. It's foolishness. Do you follow me, church? He's going to be with you, and you're going to be under his wings, and in the palm of his hand. He's never going to leave you or forsake you. He's going to walk with you through every difficulty. He's not saying if you do something crazy and reckless, he's going to protect you from that. He says he'll protect you from the lion, but you don't go walking into the lion's cage. Are you with me? Here's the problem. Satan will always take, if he's using scripture, he will take something and twist it just enough. You're not going to really die. For God knows that the moment that you eat of this fruit, you will become like him, knowing good and evil. Well, all of that was true, but it twisted God's word. You say, also, you will die. It wasn't true that they wouldn't die. It was true that they would become like him, knowing good and evil. Because God himself says they have become like us, knowing good and evil. So we need to kick them out. Let's go over, if you will. Just a moment to the... I got to move all my magnets here because of the wind. Here we go. Let's go down to the next one. We're just going to have a few more minutes here. Look at the last one here in Matthew chapter 4. This other temptation. It says the devil, verse 8. Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain. And he showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. All this I will give you, he said, if you will just bow down and worship me. So again, how it happens, I don't know, but he takes him to this place where he's able to see in some kind of a strange visionary kind of thing, perhaps, all the kingdoms of the world and all their glory and all their splendor. And Satan says, these are all mine. Because Adam gave them to me. He was the ruler of it all, but he gave them to me when he sinned. He handed them back over to me. And you know what? I believed that for a long time. But it's not true. It's not true. You see, Jesus is the King of all kings. And he reigns over every single kingdom. And he is the Lord of all lords. But look at what he says. If you will just bow down to me, then I will give you all these kingdoms. Jesus' response was, it is written. He said, away from me, Satan. It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. And the devil left him. And I believe the angels bought some good food and ministered to him, and slowly he started to get his strength back as they ministered to him. He said, away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord and serve him only. This temptation was a crazy one because it was unnecessary. Jesus said, my kingdom is not of this world. My kingdom is a heavenly kingdom and surpasses everything on this world. Why would I ever want to serve on these kingdoms? And he is the King of all kings and Lord of all lords. Jesus said that we need to know in context what God has said, to saturate your mind with the Word of God so you know how to defeat the enemy when he comes and uses scriptures against you. But it's also imperative, very quickly, it's also imperative that we know God's Word, that we study God's Word so that we can do what he has commissioned us to do. What did he commission us to do? In Matthew chapter 28, you all know it, in verse 18 to 20, just before Jesus ascended into heaven, he said this, all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. You know it, say amen. All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all people groups. Make followers of all people groups, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey all that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always to the very end of the age. So I have a couple of questions here. How can we really be his disciples if we really don't know what he has said to us? How can we follow? He wants us to follow him. Now, in just a few hours, we're going to be at the DeCarlos home, and a whole bunch of you are going to be baptized. I'm going to ask you these two questions. Before you're baptized, I'm going to say, have you trusted Jesus Christ to be your Savior and Lord? And is he the master of your life? And you're going to say, yes. That's why you're there. And then I'm going to say, is it your desire to follow Jesus all the days of your life? From this day forward, forsaking all others, and you're going to say, yes, it is. It is my desire to follow him. Well, how on earth can we follow Jesus if we don't know what he has said? You may know that he died for you and that he wants you to have a kingdom and that he loves you so and that your sins could be forgiven if you confess your sins. But how can you know where he wants you to go and to follow him if you don't know God's word? How can we teach others what we really don't know? Can I get an amen? And how can we respond? Listen carefully. How can we respond to the pagan world, which doesn't know Christ, when they quote Scripture to us out of context? I had a man say to me this past week, he had a question. He said, Pastor, if Jesus came to fulfill the law, not to destroy the law or abolish the law, why don't we follow the law? Why don't we follow the law of Moses? Would you be able to answer him? Well, there is a law that we follow of Moses. It's the moral law. We follow the moral law. All the moral law we're supposed to follow. But the ceremonial law, we don't follow anymore. We see with the sheet that came down with Peter that all of the foods were now declared good. We don't have to follow the dietary laws and all of the different holidays that were meant to be done because we're now Jew and Gentile combined. We don't have to follow the ceremonial law. We don't have to follow the civil law. In fact, we can't follow the civil law, or many of us in this room would be dead because somebody would have stoned us for carrying sticks on the Sabbath, right? If we follow the civil law. But no, we have to come under the law of the land, and that's what is found in the book of Romans. So the civil law is gone, but the moral law we have to follow. But I know that because I know what God's word says about it. Would you be able to handle that? And then a woman came up to me, I was talking to her on the phone, and we were talking about tattoos. Now I'm going to step on a couple of toes, all right? She said, doesn't the Bible say we're not supposed to get a tattoo? We were talking because I want to get this big honking tattoo right here on my shoulder. No, that's not true. I'm not one to like to inflict pain on myself unnecessarily. Some of you love it. But the bottom line is I couldn't care less if you have a tattoo or not. Some of those tattoos are a distraction, but we're talking about it. And so I said to her, yeah, it does say you're not supposed to tattoo your body right before it says you are not to clip the curls on the sides of your head, nor are you to trim your beards. And for some reason, we have no problem trimming our beards and cutting our hair. And that's a ceremonial law that had to do with pagan worship and the praying for the dead and the sacrificing to the dead. But that is a ceremonial law, and that's been done away with. That's not an encouragement for you to get tattoos. Parents, don't get on me for this. It's just simply saying that if we're going to honor that ceremonial law and put ourselves under the law, then we also can't trim our beards, we can't cut things, we can't blend our fabrics together, we can't do an awful lot of things that are right in that exact same paragraph. So we've got to be careful about that. But would you be able to handle that question? Do you know what the context is to what God says? You can't know it. And the enemy's going to come in there through an individual, and they're going to say what you believe is wrong because here it is in the scripture, right there, out of context, you should be doing this. And you say, but the bigger context in which it fits is this. Do you follow me? Know what God says. How can we respond to the pagan world which does not know Christ when they quote scripture to us out of context? Because we know what came out of the mouth of God. And then, how can we know who we truly are in Christ if we don't know his word? Lastly, there are all kinds of verses that should compel us or spur us on to read God's word. Here's a couple. Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a what? Light unto my path. It guides the way. Your word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against you. The word of God is living and active, sharper than any double-edged. Amen. You know this. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and the attitudes of the heart. Psalm 119, and it's my understanding, sister, you're doing Psalm 119 in your study, which happens right after this, right? If you want to join with it, just started a couple of weeks ago. Psalm 119, every single verse of the longest song, the longest chapter in the entire Bible, 150 verses, every single verse has something to do with the Word of God. Psalm 119, all of these should motivate us to get into God's Word. But as Jesus said, and here we close, as Jesus said, while he was starving to death, man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. If that does not compel you to get into the Bible every day or as often as you can, this is not coercion, this is not manipulation, this is not trying to make you feel guilty, but as often as you can, that you might know the author better, I don't know what else could. Amen? Amen. Challenge. before you eat. Well, you've already been the word today, so you can eat today. If you haven't already. But before you eat tomorrow, or at least somewhere down the line, get into God's word. Amen? Amen? Let's pray. Loving Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that the Lord Jesus, even in this extreme physical anguish of body, told the enemy that even though he was greatly hungry, Lord, that it was more important that he eat on God's word. Father, I pray that somehow we take it that seriously. That even though we're hungry, it's more important that we spend time in God's word. And Father, I pray that not only would we do it so that we can check off a box in our spiritual calendar, but that we would get to know you better. That we would know so that when the enemy comes with all of his lies, especially in these last days, spoken by people with consciences that have been seared as with a hot iron, that we would have the right answer and we can say, but it is also written. It's also written. And we would know what the truth is. So, Father, I pray for this church that they would be spurred on by your Holy Spirit to do that and that they would share with one another what they have found. Now, Father, I just pray if there's anything on my flesh that has crept into this message, may it be quickly forgotten. May only those things of you remain, I pray in Christ's name. Amen. Can I have your attention for just a couple more moments, please? As you do this, as you start this journey, perhaps, maybe you've been on this journey all your life, but as you start it, for some of you, I'm going to ask that you would do me a favor. When you find something that is fascinating, that you never saw before in the Word of God, would you share that with me? I'm a young man. December 31st, I hit that middle age point. I will be 60. And I'm middle age, that's for me. I'm planning to live to 120, so that's middle age for me. And I have a long life to learn a lot more about the Scriptures, so share with me. I want to tell you something. I was listening to the Word of God on my CDs, in my truck, this past week, and my heart was so blessed concerning the COVID vaccine by what David wrote in Psalm 68. I'm going to let you look it up. I'm not going to tell you which verse it is, but when I heard him say that, I jumped off the page, as it were, jumped off the CD into my ears. I said, wow! And I shared that with a lieutenant in the military right now, struggling with the whole dilemma. And I said, shared with him from Psalm 68, and he said, Roger that, Pastor Randy. He got it, and I think you're going to get it too. It's not the end of the world. We're going to look at this. And when you see what David writes about something that he had to do, I think you're going to be blessed. But if you're blessed by other things, please share them with me. Are you with me, church? Amen. Would you stand for the benediction, and then you are dismissed. Thank you for your attention today. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all that we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, now and forevermore. Amen. Pastor, would you give me your attention for just a moment? Looks like Pastor's got a moment. Be good. You behave yourself.